Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. And at question number one, I call Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it is taking to tackle child poverty.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Eradicating child poverty in Scotland is a national mission and the First Minister's top priority. We are supporting families in a variety of ways, including through the game-changing Scottish Child Payment, funded childcare, free bus travel for under-22s and free school meals for over 277,000 children. We have also opened up a £1.5 million fund to help clear school meal debt. Modelling published in February estimates that our policies will keep 100,000 children out of relative poverty in 24-25, and I'll deliver a statement to Parliament by the end of June updating on progress in tackling child poverty.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. And it is very welcome that the Scottish Child Payment and other Scottish Government policies will lift an estimated 100,000 children out of poverty this year. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if the Scottish Government has had any discussions with UK counterparts, Tory and Labour, to persuade them of the benefits of what the SNP Government has done here, and to introduce their own UK child payment, which of course would lead to more Barnett consequential money coming here, so that we could do even more to eradicate child poverty in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we have repeatedly called for the UK Government to match the scale of our ambition here in Scotland, and that includes making changes to the reserve benefit system because, of course, the majority of benefits are still reserved to the UK. Most importantly, I think, is to introduce an essentials guarantee to reverse damaging welfare cuts such as the two-child limit. That, in themselves, would lift 40,000 children out of poverty here in Scotland this year. It is disappointing, therefore, that both the UK Government and the Labour Party have not entertained these types of changes and are still absolutely determined to keep the two-child cap.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister has set out tackling child poverty as his key mission and has acknowledged that there are still almost one in four children in Scotland living in poverty. Given the importance the Cabinet Secretary and the First Minister takes tackling hunger, can the Cabinet Secretary tell me if the Government will listen to key stakeholders such as Aberlour and increase the free school meal income threshold for pupils in years where free entitlement does not yet exist?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as the First Minister has laid out, we will do everything that we can to tackle child poverty, and I've detailed some of the policies we have, Presiding Officer, in my original answer. What makes it exceptionally difficult, of course, is when we see cuts to revenue and cuts to capital expenditure for the Scottish Government being delivered to us by the UK Government. And it is disappointing that the Members' Party seems absolutely determined to keep to the Tory spending plans if there was another government elected. That does tie one hand behind our back, but we will, as I've said, continue to do everything that we can to protect people in Scotland. It is a shame that the other government that also is supposed to stand up for the people of Scotland does not do so.
Yeah.
Question number two, Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it is taking to reduce waiting times for children requiring neurodevelopmental assessment.
Minister Marie Todd.
Long waits are unacceptable. To be clear, though, the CAMHS statistics capture children who meet the CAMHS criteria, and we've seen a sustained improvement in CAMHS waiting times. Children who require neurodevelopmental support are not reported in these statistics unless they also have comorbid mental health issues. So we don't have accurate data for waiting times for neurodevelopmental assessments, nor do we have a treatment time target. Our key focus is on improving support. Our neurodevelopmental specification places an expectation on NHS and children's services to work together to implement standards in line with GRFIC. Crucially, local authorities have a statutory duty to identify and provide support for pupils with additional support needs, regardless of the diagnosis. We're working with NHS boards and local authorities to improve the support available. And as part of this, Scottish Government's allocated £55.5 million to boards in 23-24 to improve mental health and neurodevelopmental services.
Poulton McGregor.
Yeah, I thank the Minister for that response. Recently I met with the Clinical Director of CAMHS in Lanarkshire and was advised that the delay has been experienced by my constituents in accessing assessment, sometimes up to 3 or 4 years, may be attributed to difficulties in recruiting and retaining psychiatrists. So can I ask the Minister to advise what further action the Scottish Government can take to alleviate these pressures in the immediate and longer term?
Minister.
Thank you. The Member is absolutely correct in his assessment. The Mental Health and Wellbeing Workforce Action Plan established a working group to consider how we best support workforce and attract people into psychiatry, including offering additional places on psychiatry training. Recruitment into core psychiatry has improved drastically in recent years. Now, not all children require specialist CAMHS. Many will be supported in their community. Local authorities have received over £50 million since 2020 and a further £15 million this year to fund community supports for children, young people and their families, which are focused on prevention and early intervention. And for schools, we published a professional learning resource for staff, providing the essential learning required to support mental health and wellbeing at all stages. We also provide £16 million a year to local authorities to fund school counselling.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There is a crisis in the delivery of care pathways for children with neurodevelopmental needs. As Fulton McGregor said, the waiting times can be in excess of 4 or 5 years. Some parents and families in my constituency have sought private diagnosis, only to find that their NHS GP will not support that diagnosis and offer prescription. Shared care arrangements exist in other parts of the NHS. What work is the government doing with NHS Scotland to allow shared care to exist in cases of neurodevelopmental need?
Minister.
So I thank the member for that question. There is, I understand, guidance on shared care from the Royal College of Psychiatrists, but of course it is down to the individual general practitioner to make a decision as to whether they accept those shared care arrangements. There is work in and guidance available in many health boards around Scotland, but it is not consistent right throughout Scotland, and of course it is down to the individual general practitioner to make the decision as to whether to enter a shared care arrangement.
Emma Roddick.
While I appreciate it's important for children and families to have the certainty of a diagnosis, this should not be necessary in order to get the right support and reasonable adjustments. So what measures are being taken to ensure that children who are awaiting assessment but have clear and identifiable needs are receiving appropriate support in schools, and how are their rights being protected and upheld in the absence of a formal diagnosis?
Minister.
So the member is absolutely correct. Support for children with neurodevelopmental needs within education is critical. Local education authorities are responsible for meeting the additional support needs of their pupils, and a diagnosis of a particular condition isn't needed for them to receive support. Children's needs should be discussed at child planning meetings. That information should help to inform assessment, formulation and diagnosis where appropriate and helpful. An individualised approach is essential to take account of developmental stage and daily environments. As I've said, and as is set out in our neurodevelopmental specification, we expect boards and children's services to work towards implementing the standards in the specification.
Thank you. Question 3 has been withdrawn and question 4 was not lodged. At question number 5, I call Pauline McNeill.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the amount of time that Police Scotland currently spends responding to calls related to mental health issues.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, I'm grateful to police officers and other frontline agencies who support people in distress or experience mental ill health. The Scottish Government and Scottish Police Authority have established a multi-agency group to ensure that people with mental health needs are able to access the right service at the right time. Officers are often the first point of contact and therefore play a vital role in supporting communities and victims of crime, but it is essential that they are able to transfer care for people with mental health needs to the services who can support them best.
Pauline McNeill.
The Chief Constable of Police Scotland, Joe Farrell, says that the police are receiving mental health related calls as frequently as 3 or 4 calls per minute on a busy day. And the Chief Constable says that the demands of mental health calls is consuming time equivalent to 600 police officers per year. And she goes on to say that officers would take those in distress to third-party support, which she's described provisions as a postcode lottery. Now, I'm aware, Cabinet Secretary, that you know all full well the implications of mental health, particularly to the job of police officers. But can the Cabinet Secretary tell me whether the Scottish Government is looking into a national triage service, for example, which the police can take or direct people in distress towards?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I can confirm to the member that there is a comprehensive range of action underway that both involves senior leadership across the government, in particular justice and health. I very much recognise that the role of policing has changed considerably over the last decade, as well as the impact of increased demand for mental health support on police and mental health services. And the partnership delivery group that I referred to in my answer is indeed developing that very comprehensive work plan to build on the work that is already in place. And if I can give one example of an exemplar, and that's NHS Lanarkshire, where they have a 73% reduction in police conveyances to emergency departments for mental health presentations since 2019. And that is because officers are able to use a triage service for consultation with a psychiatric liaison nurse.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. That's a very interesting response, because on triage, I know the Cabinet Secretary is aware of the Distress Relief Project, which is a triage service and involves agencies such as the police, NHS, fire and rescue and so on, where vulnerable individuals are directed to the correct pathway to help them deal with issues. And can I advise that Scottish Borders was one of the first places to roll it out, and I'm sure she welcomes the development of this project.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, since the launch of the pilot in Ms Graham's constituency, over 62,000 people have now been referred to our world-leading distress brief intervention programme. Police Scotland are rightly key national partners in this programme, which provides compassionate, personalised and non-clinical support to people in emotional distress who come into contact with frontline services, including police.
Question number 6, Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government when it will close the gap in funding for 1140 hours of early learning and childcare between private, voluntary and independent providers and council-run facilities.
Minister Natalie Dawn.
The local government finance settlement provides local authorities with funding covering different service areas. In 24-25, the settlement includes around £1 billion of funding for the delivery of ELC. Local authorities are responsible for designing their own ELC delivery models, and national guidance is clear that councils must set hourly rates that reflect the cost of delivery for private and third sector providers as well as childminders. Now, Mr Rennie is aware that the childcare market is a mixed economy, and businesses in the private and third sectors are responsible for making their own decisions about fees for non-funded hours, as well as overall staff terms and conditions. Equally, local authorities also face unique costs as statutory bodies. However, as I've made clear to both the Member and Parliament previously, reducing variation in the rate-setting process is a key priority for me, and the Scottish Government is working with COSLA to improve the rate-setting process across a number of areas following the Joint Sustainable Rates Review.
Willie Rennie.
But I'm afraid none of that closes the gap. I mean, this was the promise that was made by the last First Minister, that the gap would be closed. But there's been a snail's pace on this, and it's having a direct impact on retention and recruitment and capacity. All of those areas are really important, because the private and voluntary and independent sector provides the capacity and the flexibility that parents need. So has the Minister just given up on closing this gap, or what is she actually going to do to make a difference?
Minister.
Mr Rennie raises an important point here. However, I don't fully agree with his assessment. I think we need to set the scene a little. Rates have been steadily increasing since the implementation of the expansion. The average rate paid by local authorities to providers delivering funded ELC to 3- to 5-year-olds has increased by 64.1% between 2017 and 2023. While the average rate has increased, however, As I've said, there remains variation in the rates paid across Scotland, and that is why the Scottish Government and COSLA undertook that joint rates review. We recognise this has been a challenging period for the childcare sector, and this review is clear that there is more to do to ensure that those rates are set sustainably for all funded providers. The review recommends a wide-ranging set of actions, and some of the next steps include enhancing the guidance on the approach to rate setting, developing guidance around the rates for two-year-olds, meal rates, and setting clearer guidance around engagement. So I'm positive that these will have the impact that Mr Rennie wishes to see, and I'm happy to keep him updated on this.
Ros McCall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Due to funding pressures in local authorities, families across Scotland are faced with a postcode lottery when it comes to assessing 1140 hours of funded childcare. With some local authorities offering funded childcare immediately following a child's third birthday, some offering childcare a month after a third birthday, and others delaying access, in some cases for months, until the following school term. So what will the Minister do to rectify this disparity and support all parents, but particularly working parents, to accessible childcare?
Minister.
I understand that this is an issue, and as I've said, there is a host of ongoing work in relation to both supporting providers but ensuring that our offer is quality, accessible and affordable for parents. That's certainly something that I will take away and look into for the member.
Question number 7, Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it will take in response to the call from the NASUWT Teachers Union for a system of strategies to be put in place for dangerous and disruptive behaviour, including consequences for pupils.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
I want to make clear that the existing policy framework, including the national policy on exclusion, does not prevent the use of consequences. However, I have been listening carefully to the concerns of the teaching profession and to members across the chamber on the need for further clarification and support on this issue. In the coming weeks, we will publish a comprehensive national action plan to respond to evidence from our behaviour in Scottish Schools Research and last year's Relationships and Behaviour Summits. This plan will be jointly owned with COSLA and has been developed in collaboration with the Scottish Advisory Group on Relationships and Behaviour in Schools. The NASUWT are a member of SAGRABIS and have provided valuable input into the development of this plan.
Stephen Kerr.
The Cabinet Secretary knows that teachers just want to be safe at work. A teacher told me yesterday, nothing's being done, nothing is changing, there are no sanctions, nobody seems to care. And Mike Corbett of the NASUWT Scotland said, the Cabinet Secretary cannot claim to be in any doubt about what is needed to help address the problem. She needs to show real leadership by putting in place national guidelines that make it clear to schools what is expected of them and which uphold teachers' right to work in safety. Will she?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank the member for his interest in this issue. And of course, I met with Mike Corbett on Tuesday of this week, and we regularly engage in relation to issues in relation to behaviour and relationships. And the member will recall when he previously held the post of being the education spokesperson for his party, that it was his debate that necessitated some of the action the government has taken on this very issue. And I recognise his ongoing interest to that end. Since June of last year, of course, a range of different actions have been taken. I established a head teachers task force, which met again yesterday to discuss behaviour. We have chaired a number of behaviour summits to discuss a range of issues on relationships and behaviour.
Excuse me, Cabinet Secretary. Mr Lumsden, I'd be grateful if you could resist contributing from your seat. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've also published national research that I mentioned into nearly 4,000 teachers and support staff's experiences. It is important that the government listens to these views, and I've engaged extensively with Scotland's teaching unions. In November, I set out a five-step action plan confirming funding for support staff and also, to the member's point, providing that clarity at national level on advice and guidance to schools in relation to consequences. I think that's hugely important, but that work has to be jointly owned with COSLA, which is why the publication of this action plan and the steps the government is going to take will take place in the coming weeks.
Thank you. Question number 8, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it can intervene in light of concerns following NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde's decision to permanently reduce Inverclyde's GP out-of-hours service, reportedly leaving Inverclyde Royal Hospital as the only GP out-of-hours site in the NHS board not to operate a full 7 days a week overnight service.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Decisions about local service provision are the responsibility of health boards based on their population needs. However, Scottish ministers expect boards to ensure they deliver a safe and sustainable service to the communities that they serve. I understand that the board have undergone a full service change consultation exercise supported by Healthcare Improvement Scotland, which led to this decision. And the board have reviewed the results of the public consultation, current performance, capacity and demand, as well as the overall sustainability and safety of the board-wide out-of-hour service before determining this position.
Jamie Green.
People served by Inverclyde Royal Hospital will now not have access to the same level of locally delivered out-of-hours GP care as they did before. They will instead have to take a 50-mile round trip to Paisley, or as many fear, will simply present at A&E, adding burden to an already strained hospital. Now, this all flies in the face of the government's own commitment of parity across Scotland to locally delivered healthcare. 80% of local residents oppose this reduction, and most local politicians oppose it too. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to please tell the people of Inverclyde why they don't deserve the same levels of local, out-of-hours GP care that people elsewhere in Scotland enjoy?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Jamie Green for his question. There's a couple of points in there that I wish to stress. Ensure the ongoing accessibility of the service. Irrespective of the patient location, the board have formalised a process for offering patient transport for patients who are required to receive care at the PCEC, and of course a home visiting service is available across the board area if patients are clinically assessed as requiring this level of care. The demand partly drove this decision I have previously referred to, but in the interest of brevity, Presiding Officer, I'd be more happy to meet Mr Green to discuss the concerns that he has and what actions Greater Glasgow and Clyde are taking in order to support patients in this area.